So in this video, I'm gonna show how a concrete patio like this can be poured in a do-it-yourself style without the use of rebar and or any metal reinforcement. And I'm also gonna show a similar concrete project that I poured several years ago and how it's holding up today. So here we go. If we understand the characteristics of concrete, we can better adjust our building techniques to build a concrete structure that is long-lasting. And the takeaway points from concrete is that when it's cured, it handles compression forces very well, meaning it can be smushed. However, it does not like tension forces. It does not like to be pulled. In the case of concrete, tension often comes from like a flexion force. And that's why in heavy load applications, like our spanning applications, like big beams, that's why something like steel reinforcement will be used, because the tension forces would basically be kind of applied to the metal, and or the metal would take out those tension forces and minimize any of those forces on the concrete itself. So in something like a patio that's only expecting light foot traffic, we have some wiggle room in how we can build this. And as long as we know that concrete is good in compression but weak in tension, if we build our structure to minimize tension forces, essentially minimize any flexion points, we should be able to build a long-lasting concrete structure without metal reinforcement. Okay, so the first thing I want to do in a project like this is to prep the foundation. We want a foundation that's solid, and we want it to be solid over the life of the concrete. We want to minimize movement. So we want to get rid of anything that can rot. Just get rid of any leaves or any roots or those kind of things. Because the problem is if you leave organics, over time they'll decompose. That could leave some voids, and then that could lead to some movement over time. And we want to minimize that. And then I would come back and compact the base substrate very well. Now I'm in a lucky situation here, mild climate, we don't get hard freezes, and I have good base substrate, so I can put my concrete straight on this existing base. However, if you are in a region that does get hard freezes, you may need to dig down deeper, you may need to add some aggregate base, because that will help with drainage and things and some stability, because if you do get hard freezes and you get water underneath, that could create some movement of the concrete, and we don't want that. But in this region, I'm lucky, I don't need to do that, I can work with the existing base material we have. So the next step, I'm gonna go ahead and put some foam borders between the fixed surfaces. In this case, I've got a brick wall and then the new concrete. What that will do, it will serve as a form for me, as well as an expansion joint between the two materials, because they may slightly expand and contract with different temperatures that could create forces we don't want. So we are separating those joints there. Hold on one second. I like to do concrete in smaller sections. The smaller something is, the harder it is to break. So going back to my chalk example, I don't want to break any more of my kids' chalk, but if you have something longer, it's easier to break. If it is smaller, it's much harder to break, and that's because we have less leverage forces, and that is true for concrete as well. So I think it's better to do smaller sections to minimize the chances for concrete cracking.
Okay, once I get the form board where I want it, I just tack it off with a screw.
So I went ahead and I formed up my first section. I'm going to do this in three sections just because I need to be able to work the concrete by hand. There's just no room. If I made it too long, I wouldn't be able to actually get over there and work it by hand. So what I did is I used the 2x2 on the outside here, the foam on the walls, and a 2x4 here. And that's going to make about a 43x43-inch square. Now, prior to pouring the concrete, I compact the soil one last time, and then I spray it down to keep moisture from getting sucked out of the concrete. We want our concrete to be strong, and big part of that is how the concrete is mixed. And if you look on the concrete bag itself, it will give very precise amounts of water to use. Generally speaking, the less water, the stronger the concrete. However, it can be very difficult to mix concrete with the recommended amounts listed on the bag. What I typically do is I do mix the concrete a little bit wetter. That way I can work with it a little bit more easier. It's a little more forgiving. And I understand I may sacrifice some concrete strength for that, but for the application of my light foot traffic concrete pad, I think that is okay, and in my case, it always has been. So just food for thought. And another option is to mix with a concrete mixer. Now I just kind of place the concrete and I push it into position using a wood float. And anywhere I have any voids, I go ahead and I tamp the concrete down to fill the voids and to get any air pockets out of the concrete. And once it's relatively flat, I take a screed board, which is just a straight edge board, and I just kind of rub it back and forth, and I fill any low spots with the concrete, and I do this all the way to the edge of the floor.
I'm gonna use a mag float.
And after the concrete has set a bit, I go ahead and I use an edger tool to soften the edges of the concrete. Now after the concrete has sat a bit, I go ahead and I want to keep it moist. And I want to keep the concrete wet for at least a week or so to help with the curing process, to ensure the maximum strength of the concrete. I wait till the next day to take the forms off, and I just use a sledgehammer and lightly tap along the length of the form, and it pops right off. Now I install a little bit of plastic here to separate the two pieces of concrete, and then I mix up and I start again, and I repeat the process, filling the void with concrete, spreading it around, using the wood float, filling in the gaps, and then leveling it out.
So one of the trickiest things about concrete is knowing when to start finishing it. And I'm no expert in this. I think this is where having vast amounts of experience finishing concrete helps out. But basically I waited about an hour and a half or so. It's pretty hot out. The sun's right on it. I'm gonna go ahead and start using a magnesium float now to trowel it to finish. And I'm stopping at the mag float finish because for what I'm doing here, it leaves a little bit of texture and I don't need it to be polished. I wanted to have a little bit of texture for foot traffic.
Using a broom to create a finish is also a good option here.
So to remove the form, I'm gonna put a screw in here like this. And I'm gonna take this.
So I put the expansion foam basically anywhere the concrete would reach a fixed surface. That gives a little space for expansion and contraction, then minimize cracking.
And then here I add some concrete to low spots and then just trowel it into place. Using this control joint tool, I'm putting the control joint right where the concrete forms a corner because that's where it's most likely to crack. And here's a look at the concrete patio complete. And as I said, it's important to keep it moist, so I'm gonna keep it wet for at least a week or so while it cures. And here's a look at the other side in progress. So this is a concrete pad I built several years ago now using similar techniques. And I wanted to show you how it's held up. Essentially, it has been fine. There are no obvious cracks anywhere and it's working flawlessly. This is again, basically a concrete patio. It only gets light foot traffic and it's been working as designed flawlessly. And I imagine it's gonna last pretty much forever without any major issues. Now, I do wanna share an example of a concrete driveway that does not have rebar. And basically just goes to show that technique matters. In this case, this was not done by me. This was done by the builder contractors. This house was built. My understanding is they did no ground prep. They probably used a wet mix and they did nothing after they poured. They didn't keep the concrete wet over time or anything like that. And here's what this looks like today. In summary, the takeaway points are: have a good solid foundation, prep the ground good, mix the concrete with an appropriate amount of water, keep the concrete damp for a good period of time after it cures, maybe a week or so. Don't put heavy loads on it. Don't try to drive a diesel truck up on a concrete patio. If you do all these things, if you minimize flexion forces, it's likely that this concrete will last a very long time and you didn't need to add metal reinforcement. Now, one thing I do want to add here, when you're pouring a thinner slab, and if you do use something like metal reinforcement, especially something like rebar, you got to be a little cautious here because yes, it could add some strength theoretically. However, in a thinner slab, it may be more likely that that rebar is going to get wet and rust over time. And if it starts to rust, the rebar itself can swell. That swelling can crack the concrete. In this application, it wasn't needed for what I was doing. And I think if it's done right, a concrete patio can be built without metal reinforcement and last a very long functional life. And if you're curious about the concrete patio I poured several years ago, here's a video to that project. Thanks for watching.